Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Father, as we come to you this morning looking for you to speak to us, our hearts are open and knowing that what you have is the best that can possibly be. We ask you to bless this time. May we be enriched because of your words to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Have you ever heard the term follow your heart? If you Google that, you can come up with just about anything. And what started this out was a thing on Facebook that a friend from the mainland, a young man, used to be in the youth group at our church over there. He's grown now, and you know how you think, oh, he must be, you know, 25. He's probably 30. But he posted this kind of anyway. It says, "I believe that the only true religion consists of having a good heart." It's a quote from the Dalai Lama. And I've noticed some of his things that he's gotten a little bit away from maybe the foundation of his youth. So I just responded by putting a couple of scriptures in there. And he responded back, "Oh, thank you for telling me those." And so I asked him, "Did you read them?" Wanted to know. But follow your heart. That seems to be that. Anyway, that started me thinking about some other things. So I kind of Googled that. One of the things that came up was follow your heart, for your heart will always know the answer. But if it tells you to strangle kittens or something, then don't follow it anymore. I mean, it's just a heart, right? It's not the Dalai Lama. And I thought that was a perfect fit to this quote from the Dalai Lama. And that's from Edward Munken. I don't know if you know who he is. I'd never heard of the name. And then as soon as, those goofy cartoons. There's one called The Pig of Happiness and Always Be Yourself, Live Your Dreams. He's got a bunch of goofy cards and cartoons and so on. But I thought that tied to the Dalai Lama. And then, of course, your heart is free. Have the courage to follow it. You know, something from Braveheart. Wherever you go, go with all your heart. Confucius. You can find quotes, follow your heart, from, you know, Helen Keller to Martina McBride, Steve Jobs to Jennifer Aniston, Nelson Mandela to Kenny G, Queen Elizabeth to Conway Twitty. I mean, everybody seems to have sometime or another said, follow your heart. There were movies with that title going back to 1936, 1990, 1998, 2015. There was even a TV series, I'm not sure what it was on, called Follow Your Heart. And then, to top it all off, there's a vegan cheese brand called Follow Your Heart. Whoa! So, if we're to follow our heart, what is it? What is it we're going to follow? Well, first of all, what we're talking about this morning is not this organ that is pumping away in our bodies and has been since the moment of birth, since before birth, and will beat until that last breath. We're not talking about that, and we're not necessarily talking about, you know, Valentine's Day and all the romantic things that have to do with hearts or emojis and that sort of thing. We want to focus on what the Bible has to say about the heart. Now, the Greek word for heart is cardia. It's in the Bible 1,000 times referenced, but never really is it talking about the physical heart. It's talking about what is defined as our mind, our emotions, and desires. And others have defined it as the affective center of our being, the desire producer that makes us tick, the capacity of moral preference, volitional desire, and choice. So those are desires of people trying to put a thumbnail sketch as to what this heart that the Bible talks about. Now, does God have a heart? Well, let's see. We just said that the heart is our mind, our emotions, desires. God has emotions, wrath, jealousy. In Numbers 25, verse 11, "Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron the priest, has turned away from my wrath, from the sons of Israel, in that he was jealous with my jealousy among them." So I did not destroy the sons of Israel in my jealousy. So God, wrath, jealousy. God has joy and rejoices. Nehemiah 8:10, do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. We should have sang that song this morning. The joy of the Lord is my strength. And then in Isaiah, for as a young man marries a virgin, so your sons will marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so your God will rejoice over you. We are the bride of Christ, and God rejoices over us. Another emotion that God shares with us. God has desires. In Psalm 51:6, it says, behold, you desire the truth in the innermost being. You being God, you desire the truth. God has compassion. In Genesis 19:16, it reads, but he hesitated, so the men seized his hand and the hand of his wife and the hands of his two daughters, for the compassion of the Lord was upon him, and they brought him out and put him outside the city. Compassion, another emotion. God loves. Any verse come to mind? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. You know, I all know that's John 3:16. So God has a heart. And if Genesis 1:27 is right, God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. We are created in God's image. If God has a heart, we have a heart. In Acts 13:22, David is referred to as a man after God's own heart. Wow. How would you like to be described? Pete, a man after God's own heart. Sharon, a woman after God's own heart. Wow. And what he was referencing was in 1 Samuel, where Samuel is addressing Saul and saying, hey, your kingdom is not going to endure. The Lord has sought out for himself a man after his own heart, and the Lord has appointed him as a ruler over his people, because you have not kept what the Lord commanded you. So this is Samuel telling Saul, hey, your kingdom's coming to an end, and I'm going to find this. The Lord has appointed a man after his own heart. He's going to find David. And then, of course, God blesses his people with leaders who know and follow his heart. Again, Samuel, but I will raise up for myself a faithful priest who will do according to what is in my heart and in my soul. And Jeremiah 3:15, then I will give you shepherds after my own heart. Boy, isn't that great to know that you have a shepherd, that you have, and I pray that for all of our pastors, that they be shepherds after God's own heart to feed on from God's knowledge and understanding. Okay, so God has a heart. Now, what does God say about our hearts? Genesis 6:5. Probably not going to like this. Then the Lord saw the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Wow, what happened next? The flood. Genesis 6:6, and as the Lord was sorry that he made man on the earth, and he was grieved. So we've got some other emotions here. God was sorry, and he was grieved in his heart, or grieved to his heart. The Lord said, I will blot out man whom I have created from the face of the land, from man to animals to creeping things and to birds of the sky, birds of the heavens, for I am sorry that I have made them. Wow. He was disappointed in what was happening to his creation. Okay, let's move to the New Testament. Maybe Jesus has something better to say. Matthew 15:19. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornication, thefts, false witness, slanders. Whoops. This isn't going so well. I thought the idea was to follow your heart. That doesn't seem to lead anywhere that's any good, at least to what we've seen so far. And then, of course, Jeremiah 17:9. And I've got this from several different translations. It's basically the same thing, but the King James says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? The New King James, virtually the same thing. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? The human heart is most deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is? That's the New Living Translation. The NIV says, the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it? The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? The English Standard Version. And then the New American Standard says, the heart is more deceitful than all else and is desperately sick. Who can understand it? The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately corrupt. Who can understand it? Crooked is the heart above all things, and it is incurable. Who does know it? And then from the Message, the heart is hopelessly dark and deceitful, a puzzle that no one can figure out. Above all things, more deceitful than all else. It appears the human heart is, in its natural condition anyway, is evil, treacherous, deceitful. And in all of those, we read, the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure, desperately sick. In other words, when sin entered the world, it affected us at our deepest level, our emotions, our soul, our will. And on top of that, it seems that we're blind to how pervasive it is, because who can understand it? Follow your heart. It seems to be the last thing you want to follow if it's that deceitful, that corrupt, that sick. Now, we may not understand our hearts, but God does. In Psalm 44:21, would not God find this out? For he knows the secrets of the heart. And in Psalm 139, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. In verse 23, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxious thoughts, and see if there be any hurtful way in me, and lead me in the everlasting way. And then over in Acts 15, verse 8, and God, who knows the heart, testified to them, giving them the Holy Spirit, just as he also did to us. So God knows our heart. Over and over we see that. God knows the very secrets. You know, we might think we're keeping secrets or we're hiding. No, God knows. So based on that knowledge, he should be able to help, right? He should be able to do something. Jeremiah again, verse 10. I, the Lord, search the heart, I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings. Because Jesus also pointed out more of our fallen condition, because in Mark 7, it's kind of repeating of what he said in Matthew. He said, from within, out of men's hearts, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, folly. Wait, I don't think he misses anything, does he? And all these evils come from inside and make a man unclean. So our biggest problem is not on what's on the outside, right? It's what's on the inside. That's what Jesus is talking about. That's where everything comes from, is our thoughts and from our heart. So what can we do? Where's the heart doctor? You know, call 911. What's going on? This is bad. It's incurable. It's deceitful. It's desperately sick. So what do you need to do? Need to be saved. What does that mean? Because the saved heart is a changed heart, and you can't necessarily fix it. You need a transplant. This only happens by the power of God in response to faith. We're going through Romans with Pastor Izzy, and Romans 10:10 says, with the heart one believes unto righteousness. Ooh, we're getting a little bit of good news. With the heart you believe unto righteousness. In his grace, God can create a new heart. Psalm 51:10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. And then in Ezekiel 36, moreover, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you and I will remove the heart of stone. God is working to create a new heart within us. That involves testing, because we heard it before, but Psalm 17 says, you tried my heart. You have visited me by night. You have tested me, and you find nothing. I have purposed that my mouth will not transgress. So he's testing. But more than just testing, he fills our hearts with new ideas. in 1 Kings 10:24. All the earth was seeking the presence of Solomon. Why? To hear his wisdom, which God had put in his heart. And then in 2 Corinthians, but thanks be to God who puts the same earnestness on your behalf in the heart of Titus. So not only does God test us, but he fills us with new ideas, new wisdom, new desires to help each other, one of them. So if the heart is the core of our being, the Bible sets a pretty high standard, right? Proverbs 4:23. Above all else, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. In Proverbs, let's see. Matthew, let's go back to Matthew. He said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Jesus was saying that in Matthew, right? But what was he quoting? He was quoting from Deuteronomy 6, verse 5. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And then Proverbs 3, verses 5 and 6, many of us probably know this. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him, and he will make your paths straight. That seems to be saying, don't trust your hearts. Don't follow your heart. We are to commit our hearts to God. And not follow our own heart. And he also gives a promise then of guidance, right? He will make your path straight. Submit to him. Now, is God really able to direct? I would hope so. If you were looking for someone to guide you, who would you look to? Say you're lost. And you run across somebody and you're asking them directions, and they say, well, I feel it's over this way. Or if you run into somebody and they've got a GPS or a map, now where would you want to put your trust? Let's see, GPS stands for God. Oh, I thought it was God's positioning system. But yeah, global positioning system. And if God can guide us, let's put our trust in him. Now, obviously, the Bible teaches us to follow God, because God declares in Jeremiah, just a few verses further before that condemnation of verse 9, in verse 7 it says, blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. John 3:20 we read, we will know by this we are of the truth and assure our heart before him that if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and knows all things. God knows all things. And when you stop to contemplate what that means, what God knows all things, does that mean he just knows all the facts and all that? He knows all what's happened. He knows all what's going to happen. He knows what would have happened if you had taken a different action. He knows what that action would have resulted in. Because Jesus says, I got ahead of myself. He says, woe to Chorazin. This is in Matthew 11:21. Woe to you, Bethsaida, for if the miracles had occurred in Tyre and Sidon, which occurred in you, they would have repented long ago. So the miracles happened here. If they would have happened here, Jesus knew what the outcome would have been. That's all-knowing. There's nothing that God does not know. And we are to follow him. Isaiah 49 says, remember the former things long past, for I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is no one like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, which have not been done, saying, my purpose will be established, and I will accomplish all my good pleasure. God knows all, everything, whether it's been done or not done, or if it would have been different. He still knows the outcome. You can't fool him. So you might as well trust him. Acts 1:21, and they prayed and said, "You, Lord, who know the hearts of all men, show us one of these two who you've chosen." This is when they were choosing someone to replace Judas. And so they pray, "You, Lord, who know the hearts of all men." Now, on top of him knowing all that, omniscience, God is good, right? God loves us. So if he knows all, he loves us, cares for us, why in the world wouldn't we follow him? That's a no-brainer. I mean, God loves me, he cares for me, he knows everything. Even when I mess up, he knows, and I know that he will forgive me. Now, why would I not place my trust in that? I'm going to do what I'm going to do. Even when it comes to discipline sometimes. As a matter of fact, my wife commented this on the way down here. One of our puppies doesn't like to sit in his dog seat. And she reminded me of that old cartoon, Dennis the Menace, from a long, long time ago. Had time out, sitting in the corner. And he's saying, "I may be sitting on the outside, but I'm standing on the inside." no show of hands, but how many times? Yeah, okay, Lord, yeah, I know. Yeah, I know. So why can I not put my full trust in a God who loves me, cares for me, and wants the best for me? Even when the circumstances aren't maybe what we all consider ideal. In and through it all, God has our interest at heart, at his heart, and he loves us and cares for us. Let's follow. Let's follow God. Let's not follow our heart. So now, let's go back and review just a little bit. What did God say about the unregenerate heart? Remember Isaiah 17:9, the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure, incurable, desperately sick, all those things. There seems to be two reasons why we shouldn't follow it. First of all, deceitful above all things. That's a pretty tall list. Deceitful above everything else? Wait a minute. There's got to be worse things than my heart. Am I that bad? Yeah. Because then he says, who knows it, right? I'm blinded to it. I don't even know how bad it is. Deceitful above all things, who can understand it? Don't even know it. Don't even know how bad it is. We don't seem to be able to tell right from wrong. And as you look around in our world today, there seems to be a lot of that. And see, that used to be wrong, and now it's right. Or they're telling me it's right. Anyway, little ancient history here. Song from eons ago. Let's see, there are a few of us with the gray hair. We might remember this. "You Light Up My Life." Debbie Boone. Yeah, nice song. You know, it was number one and all that good stuff. Remember that line from it, though? Kind of unfortunate. "It can't be wrong when it feels so right." Oops. You know, relying on feelings, not quite the way to go. It's also unbiblical, dangerous and unbiblical. So then the second part says that is desperately wicked, desperately sick, corrupt beyond cure. There's no way to fix the heart. You need a new one. That's why when a person comes to faith in Christ, what happens? You're a new creation. A new creature. 2 Corinthians 5:17, many of you might be able to quote it. "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature, a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new." So Jesus just doesn't fix your heart. He replaces it with a new one. So now we've got a new heart. Does that mean we can rely on it? Boy, that'd be easy, wouldn't it? And did anybody ever tell you you become a Christian and you have no problems, you have no issues, and so on? Doesn't happen, does it? Sometimes there are more issues that one has to deal with. Temptation never goes away. Galatians 5:17, the flesh desires what is contrary to the spirit, and the spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. You still can't do whatever you want, even if Christ gives you a new heart, if you're a new creation, new creature. Remember, we've been talking, again, I refer to Pastor Izzy in Romans, and let's see, Romans 7, what does Paul say? For the good that I want to do, I do not do, but I practice the very evil I do not want to do. Paul, man, an apostle, and he's a new creation, he's a new creature, he's got a new heart, and he struggles with doing what he's not supposed to do and not doing what he is supposed to do. Anybody else relate? I know I can. I know I can. So again, we have an all-knowing, omniscient God who loves and cares for us. He also promises to give us wisdom. James 1, verse 5. But if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. If you lack wisdom, ask. Making a decision, ask. And we have his written word, or his digital word, depending on what you're used to. And in our move, our Bibles got displaced or misplaced or whatever. And I got used to using the Bible apps, and I love them. I mean, there's YouVersion. You can if you don't know how to do it, ask your kids or grandkids, and they'll set you up right now. But there are several apps, and I still like to flip pages or keep my finger in one place and go back. I'm kind of learning how to do that now, but it's great. So, and in 2 Timothy 3:16, all Scripture is inspired by God. Inspired, God breathed, and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness. Now, it doesn't say, and I was kind of blessed by this, it doesn't say all written Scripture. It says all Scripture, right? So I don't think we can throw out the digital versions. You know, I think they're all still okay. And by the way, if you want to go to the App Store and look for Bible apps, and they're there. They're easy to find. And your computer as well, you can Blue Letter Bible and YouVersion. There's quite a few of them. If that's something that would help in your Bible study or in your reading. So, back to my point. We have an all-knowing, omniscient, loving God that cares for us, and he says that he'll give us wisdom if we just ask. We have his word to guide us. So with that, why would we turn our backs on that and want to follow our heart that is deceitful and incurable when we have God that we can follow? God wants us to commit to him, loves us, and wants to do that. Now, many of us have perhaps made that. We are new creatures, new creation in Christ. Some maybe not quite yet. No better day than today. No better day than today. And it's a step of faith or a leap of faith. What sometimes looks like a leap of faith is merely a step, because all it takes is what we just read about in Romans, faith. Where was it? I just read it. No, I can't find it. Anyway, it's by faith that we come to know Jesus Christ. And that's how we can get a new heart, new heart. And won't it be great when someday the Lord will say, Alfred, a man after God's own heart, or any Valerie, a woman after God's own heart, or Connie, Carl, any of us. Wouldn't that be good to hear a compliment from God that we were striving to follow His heart, striving to follow what He has for us, because He's got the best for us. So we're not going to turn our backs on Him and follow some whimsical, magical heart somewhere. We're going to strive to follow God. And I hope you would all join me today in saying, yes, if I haven't, I'm going to. I want to follow God. If I haven't made that step of faith, I'm going to do it today and say yes to God. I want God to be in control of my life, and I want to follow Him. Anyway, I'm going to have the worship team come back up, and we're going to do one song, a little closing song. It's a little faster than Pastor Izzy. They'll probably edit this out, but I've been in church services where pastors have missed several opportunities to close. Not that that ever happens with Izzy or not. But we're actually going to be closing a little bit earlier. I probably spoke faster than I should have. Yeah, I see a couple people nodding their heads. I get going, and I don't know what it is, but Lord, slow those words down into their hearts and let them hear it. And Father, as we kind of come to a time of close here and look to You, we want to follow You. And if we take a step to the right or the left, guide us, Lord. Give us wisdom to know when we can come back and be just exactly where You would have us to be, following You to Your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.